we've typically done as a format for these regional workshops. I will kick us off with a national and statewide update for a lot of the activities that we've been busy with statewide. So this is just going to be kind of a broad brush on.
There's the remote and turn it on and decide.
Okay. Got it.
That's it.
Got it. So this presentation will hopefully kind of just touch on some of the key projects that I think have happened over the past year or so to give you guys kind of a perspective on what's been going on elsewhere around the state and the nation, and perhaps give you some ideas for future development in this area. So I'll start up on the national perspective. We meet annually with my counterparts at all the other coastal states. Our last meeting was just at the end of February. And we are working on, we had a presentation from Mike Barnett, who also presented at our Southwest workshop and Southeast workshop on some of the marine turtle concerns and the design implications for marine turtle protection. We also reviewed from the state of Alabama a large ship RFP process. And this was an approach that they took to select a ship. They had a dollar amount available and they identified the selection criteria and they had different vendors propose on that. That was the first time that a ship had kind of been approached in that way. So I found that was quite unique. Historical resource review for new artificial reef permits is something that all the coastal states are starting to deal with in regard to protecting not just the modern historical archaeological resources, but also the prehistoric resources that you find, especially off this area around some of those historic river channels. And then finally, we are working on updating the guidelines for artificial reef materials. You will find that I've got a few copies on the FWC table of the old version that was dates back to 2004. So all the states were working on providing an update to that. Another major, I think, national accomplishment this past year was the Artificial Reef Symposium that together with Florida Sea Grant, FWC, hosted in Tampa. We had 24 oral presentations, 11 poster presentations, and it was real critical. I think a key component of that is that we brought, for the first time, some of the stock assessment biologists from NOAA to the table. Steve Bortone has been working on editing a book of some of the presentations, and he's combined that with the presentations that were held also in August 2018 of the international workshop. So I think he's got 20 chapters in there, and the anticipated publication date is September 2018. And I wanted to mention that all those presentations can be viewed online, as well as this workshop and the other workshops, by visiting floridaseagrant.org/artificial reef. So I really encourage everyone to dig into some of that resource that Sea Grant is putting out there for us. Looking closer to home, the state of Florida and the statewide, you know, looking back to 1985, Grove and Sonu kind of came up with, you know, how do we define what a reef area is? You know, there's a lot of different terminologies out there. You have deployments, which could be a barge load, or it could be a single module, could be a cluster of materials, or the entire permit area. So we've typically defined a reef, or rather a patch reef, as it could be a group of deployments at least 150 feet apart. And so we've been going back through our artificial reef database, identifying the center points of patch reefs, you know, which, and then the deployments, which could be around those patch reefs. And then with the help of some side scan sonar, and you'll see a little more today from Taj on that, we're able to identify the footprint and create polygons of that. And for management purposes, and especially future planning, when we're going back and revisiting some old sites, this type of detailed information has been extremely valuable. Okay. In 2017, we had 105 patch reefs deployed statewide. That was 18,000 tons of concrete, over 1,000 concrete modules, 4 vessels, barges, 3 tons of metal structures, primarily these steel spools that were deployed off of the Mexico Beach area, and about 2,000 tons of limestone boulders. So on the Atlantic coast, there's 11 of those patch reefs. 94 of those patch reefs are on the Gulf Coast, primarily in Northwest Florida, which is where we have the funding for the natural resource damage assessment, some of the BP oil spill money helping to build some of those. If you look at where we're at in our history of our program from the start of the recording, going back into the 1960s or so to present, we have the 40% concrete, that 30% modules, which continues to trend upwards, 16% vessels, 8% metal structures, 4% rock, and 2% other, which includes some materials that are no longer permitted, old tire reefs and things like that, for a total of 3,344 artificial reef patch reefs in our public database. As far as funding is concerned at the state level, we still are relying heavily on our federal funds from sport fish restoration, as well as state funds from our Marine Resource Trust Fund, which comes from the revenues from your fishing licenses. And we are back, we had some supplemental funding a couple of years ago, special appropriations from the legislature that gave us some additional funds. But we're back the past 3 years, we've been steady funded at $600,000. And that $600,000 is what we announced in January for grant applications that are competitively selected from by the counties. I did want to point out the special project, the NERDA that I mentioned, that is $11.4 million, and $9.8 million of which is going towards construction. And that, is, as you can see, is a significant contribution to the history of Florida's artificial reef development. A summary of that project, it's primarily to improve the human use, to offset the loss of human use fishing activity and diving during the oil spill. So we have components of that include monitoring of human use following construction. So far, we have about just over 1,000 artificial reefs deployed, modules deployed, 121 patch reefs. We're about halfway through on that project. And that project includes some snorkeling reefs. Here's an example off of Walton County. They've been deploying these pilings jetted down to maintain stability during storms, and they're accessible by snorkeling or kayak from the beach. Have been quite popular. Here's a photo off of Walton County. The visibility can be quite good up there, and it's been real popular with the local communities. And then working around the state, we'll start with Okaloosa County. This is it's a secondary use concrete deployment. They were utilizing concrete materials that were acquired from Eglin Air Force Base. There was deployed a 700-ton split between two different permit areas. There were some logistical challenges in that working on the Air Force Base. The contractors only had access to the property where this material was staged during certain times. So that caused the material to be double handled and ended up being a much higher cost, I think, than if the county had a more readily accessible waterfront staging area. Charlotte and Sarasota County, together with the funding through the Reef Ball Foundation, deployed 100 concrete modules and 226 tons of limestone boulders, some of which were quite large. You can see in the photo here, some of them being pushed off in that dump truck structure. Manatee County also deployed 1,400 tons of limestone materials, and I included some photos here of the side scan sonar imagery just from their transom mounted hummingbird unit, and that has been very helpful to document the footprint. The as-built immediately after deployment, they did have some permitting challenges in that some of the material had kind of a dark color to it, and the Army Corps regulatory permit person who was reviewing the each barge load had some questions about that. So that caused some delays in that. So the conclusion to that, I think, to perhaps improve communication with the regulatory staff that might have questions, just to make it clear on the type of material and the size of the boulders that were being deployed. Some of them were a little bit small too. Lee County, their last deployment was in 2012, so they were pleased to get 1,000 tons of material out there in two patch reefs. And I wanted to conclude with on the Gulf Coast with Hernando County, and you'll be hearing more from Chuck Morton on this project, but I wanted to include it in my slides because it had been over 20 years since Hernando had been in deployment. So this was a real achievement for Hernando County and I think for the Big Bend area. And you know, this was 616 tons of good quality secondary use material and a few modules. And of all the deployments that we've been on, you know, here's a picture of the observer boat. You know, this is the first time in a long time where there was cheering, literally clapping from the first piece of concrete that went over right to the last one. So this was such a great positive thing for the local community, and I'm so pleased that you know, to share that success. And we'll look forward to hearing more from Chuck on this later. Moving over to the East Coast, Brevard County has been continuing to develop one of their sites in about 60 feet of water. They've deployed 23 prefabricated modules, and they had highly accurate. This is this little plot here is the post-deployment location. Typically, you know, in the past, we'd see, you know, you plan to have a grid layout, and it ended up more looking like a shotgun. But in this case, with a GPS on the end of the boom, they were able to get accurate placement for each individual module. And that's something we are seeing a lot more of, I think, you know, as a trend statewide. St. Lucie County deployed 1,000 tons of concrete and a 195-foot barge. And these were in memorial to a longtime consultant and a good friend to many of ours, a technical diver, one of the few folks that was going down and getting observations on some of the deeper artificial reefs, Kerry Dillon. And so here's a photo of some of that material. Palm Beach County has been busy in some of their partnership with the Red Harris Foundation. I think CCA also contributed some funding to this project as well. These are some unique modules. They're calling the coral head modules. And here you can see that, you know, they've also having some fun with some of their post-deployment photos as well. So Palm Beach County also completed what was the largest artificial reef by tonnage deployment in the state of Florida in 2017 at 1,600 tons of bridge material from the old Flagler Bridge. That was 20 barge loads deployed between two patch reefs. It makes for an excellent drift dive in that area, very popular with the local folks. The largest ship deployment during 2017 was the Okinawa tugboat deployed off of Pompano Beach. And this one had a number of unique things associated with it. First is, I think there was some live drone footage. We were unable to make the trip down there, but, you know, because of the live footage from the drone, I was able to watch it from the comfort of my home in Tallahassee, the sinking. I'm not sure if the video will work, but they have some lift bags up on the bow here to try to help keep it upright as it was deployed. The previous deployments of that, they had some troubles with the Rapa Nui barge where it actually flipped upside down. So that was one measure that they took to try to keep it upright. They also added some artwork to the deck as well. Again, it's a popular scuba dive destination. Miami-Dade has been busy continuing with these connectivity or stepping stone reefs. They're placing limestone boulders in between older steel material and other material that they have down there to add some complexities to some of their aging artificial reef sites. Palm Beach County has also been interested in doing some deep water reefs. And for this approach, they're terming it the reef darts, where they've got these concrete bases with poles that they've manufactured. In 2017, they deployed half a dozen or so in about 110 feet of water and to determine if they would land upright, and they did. So their next approach is to deploy these in 500 feet of water to try to create some deep water habitat. This is a close partnership with the Palm Beach County Fishing Club. We've also had quite a few art form reefs. These are statues are becoming, you know, more popular, and especially off Southeast Florida. So here we have some examples. The Lady Luck was a steel vessel that was deployed in 2016, and they made constructed these kind of spraycrete concrete card sharks. The Lady Luck was funded by a local casino down there. As a tourist destination, they also deployed the old Deerfield Beach mailman reef. It was a concrete statue that sat in front of the Deerfield Beach post office. So they decided to sink that as an artificial reef, again, for tourism and diving. And then the Okinawa reef, here's one of the mermaid statues that they had constructed and that went down with the Okinawa ship. And then the Andrew Red Harris Foundation helped provide funding together with those coral head modules that I showed earlier. This is a replica of the Jupiter Inlet Lighthouse. So again, these are try to you know, ecotourism and some non-consumptive uses of artificial reefs. Some pending projects that we have, Palm Beach County is also hopefully anticipating the transfer of the submarine USS Clamagore. This is a museum up at Patriots Point in South Carolina. There's quite a bit of funding that's still needed to be secured. You can learn more about the project by visiting their website or by talking to Bill Horn, who's here today as well. So we're hopeful that all the pieces will kind of come in alignment to do this project. These World War II ships, there's a lot of expense that needs to go into it to prepare them, to remove the PCBs and other contaminants, you know, to make it a safe artificial reef in compliance with all the permits. Additionally, we anticipate in 2018 to see some feasibility studies moving along from the Air Force on the decommissioning of some of these towers. You may be familiar with some of these up in the Big Bend region. The Air Force no longer needs these for their training mission. And the feasibility study, as recommended by FWC through the State Clearinghouse, is that the preferred option, rather than scrapping it and bringing it on shore, a preferred option is to topple them ideally in place and create some additional reef habitat at the base of these structures. We've also had some derelict vessel questions during 2017. One local to this area was up in the Steinhatchee area, the concrete ferro cement sailboat Luis, and unfortunately there was landed up on shore. It resulted in some significant holes in the hull, and it was just not seaworthy enough. It would have cost too much to, you know, get it back to seaworthiness to sit for a tow offshore. There was also off Volusia County, and Joe Nolan is here today, had almost the possibility to reef the Navy tug that had sank in the Halifax River. It was remediated. The Coast Guard got involved, but there were PCBs and other, you know, the remediation requirements were too great, and it and ended up being scrapped instead of reefed. We're also continuing to work on studying the PCBs and the fish associated with the Oriskany artificial reef. You can read more about this project in the back. I brought a poster on that, but this is our aircraft carrier that was deployed in 2006, and as a cost-saving measure, the Navy received approval from the EPA to leave all the wiring and gaskets, you know, and other materials, paint that contain PCBs, to sell all the liquids, hydraulic fluids that contain PCBs were removed, but anything from the flight deck below contain those contaminants. They did toxicology analyses, and as a stipulation of receiving the permit from the EPA for disposal, the county and FWC are required to do annual monitoring of the fish. And we have, there's some thresholds. That's the green line represents the thresholds. And you know, here we're at 11 years out, and we're still detecting above that threshold that requires us to continue monitoring, and it caused the Department of Health to release some consumption guidelines in 2016 for scamp grouper and bank sea bass. At the same time, we're seeing a reduction in the number of red snapper that we're catching. You know, we used to catch 30 fish in 45 minutes. Now we're fishing for 7 hours and only getting four to last year zero. We were out last week, only caught one red snapper. So we're still there's still more of a story to this one, and we're going to be meeting more with the EPA, the county, to figure out how we're going to conclude this study. We've also been leveraging more side scan sonar technology. Our program purchased a Klein 3900, consistent with what FWRI has, which is what Taj will be sharing with you. And with that data, we've been able to go back and ground truth some of our old coordinates and assist with the permit applications for the counties, as well as help with some monitoring proposals to guide some divers on, you know, locations to do fish census and other assessments. In January 2018, there was a workshop in St. Pete. This was trying to bring all these different agencies together to share some of the offshore information. You know, we realized actually at our Southwest workshop, I gave a presentation, a similar presentation, and shared some of the data from the Silvertooth Reef site. Two presentations after me, the University of South Florida presented on some multi-beam data that they had collected, and we already had side scans. So this is an effort to try to, you know, we're a lot of us are working offshore now, and just an effort to try to better communicate so we're not duplicating our effort and maximizing our time out there. Our division's been very involved with lionfish activities, and so presently we are the Lionfish Challenge is an approach that that FWC has taken to try to get the word out about removal of lionfish, encourage more people to remove lionfish and eat lionfish, and they have a unique approach this year where they're going to announce that lionfish there are going to be tagged at 50 random artificial reef sites, and the first person that finds one of these tags lionfish is going to be eligible for a cash prize. So you can learn more about that by visiting our website and then going down to lionfish. We've also had some more awareness on marine debris, marine turtle entanglement. Again, you know, from Mike Barnett's work, that's kind of helped influence some of the regulatory updates that National Marine Fisheries Service has done. And this in 2017, they updated the 2015 programmatic opinion, which helps to streamline some of the permitting approach. So for more information, you could contact us if you haven't already seen it. And if you stick with those guidelines, it helps the permits go through a little more quickly. And again, as I mentioned earlier, there's a greater attention to historical resources and cultural approach. So we're partnering with our Department of State to try to get more detail on what we need to be doing to comply with their requirements. And at Bay County, for example, has proceeded with, through the NERDA funding, purchasing a magnetometer, which is now integrated with our Klein 3900. So we're hopeful we'll be able to address a lot of these historical resource concerns up front during the permitting process. Goliath grouper was a big issue during 2017 as our division conducted 16 workshops around the state. And next week is the FWC commission meeting in Fort Lauderdale, where the results of those workshops are going to be presented to the commission. So stay tuned on that, and you can actually, if you're interested in learning more, visit our website myfdc.com, and you can watch the presentation that was given at the workshops, and of course next week you'll hear the feedback from the FWC commissioners as well. Just in conclusion, then, we've got some save the dates up here. The commission meeting next week in Fort Lauderdale. Perdido Beach is the lionfish removal and awareness day. There's also going to be other events going on statewide about lionfish removal events. The next national AFS meeting is going to be in Atlantic City in August. I don't know if any of us will be attending this year, but they will be having a habitat symposium. And so there'll probably will be continue to be some artificial reef talks there, mostly from the northeast part of the country. And our division is planning a lionfish summit in October 2018. So that's kind of just to save the date. They haven't gotten the details. This is something they did about 5 years ago. So they're going to be doing that again. So in conclusion, well, if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them. Thanks. Are we doing okay on time? Okay. So, any questions? Oh, Keith. So the question is on the revision to the artificial reef guidelines. Are there any recommendations for permitting criteria? That was discussed at our meeting because there was a proposal that a new chapter be added called No Longer Permittable Materials. There were a number of people on the committee that reminded everyone that the guidelines was not intended to be a regulatory document. It was really, and if you read through it, you'll see it describes these are the material types, these are the pros and cons. It doesn't mean that they're prohibited or allowable. However, some of the artificial reef permits, they are referencing that as a regulatory document, but that's not what it was really intended for. So the committee will still maintain that as a more of a historical approach, rather than a regulatory document. Joe?
As far as the lift bags that Broward County used to deploy the Okinawa to assist in maintaining it upright, did they work?
Yeah, so, if we could play that video, maybe Christine could play that. You know, there's a lot of force that goes down when these ships are sinking. And there is a lot of in the, oh, here we go. It's a minute long. So, typically we'll try to get it to land stern first. Because stern is usually, flatter. The bow is more pointed on the keel, and that when it strikes on the bow, it can tip, to port or starboard. In this case, you'll see it actually ended up sinking bow first. Once it goes underwater, we really don't know what the orientation is. It did end up upright. I'm not sure if, what contribution those two small lift bags had in the grand scheme of things. You'll see in a moment when it goes down. When they deployed the Lady Luck the year prior, they actually took an approach where they sealed the whole wheelhouse off, with the idea that the wheelhouse itself would give some buoyancy as it was deployed. So here you see it going down, bow first. Now it kind of gets choppy in the end, but it did lean to port. But when it touched bottom, it was upright. I don't know if it uprighted itself because of the lift bags on its travel down, or if it uprighted itself just because when it touched the keel, it leveled out.
And they Facebook live that.
Yes. Yes. If you have connectivity, Joe.
Right.
That would be fantastic if you have that connectivity out there for your project. Yeah. It's.
Oh, they did not go pro sign.
They might have. I'm not quite sure, but I know that.
Yeah, they usually do. Of course, those cameras are attached to the vessel itself. So unless there's bubbles, you can't really tell the orientation on the descent. And it probably wouldn't be safe to put a diver in the water with a camera next to me. Any other questions? So we are using for the Oriskany monitoring study, and we've invested, you know, about $700,000. You know, that's coming out. It's coming out of our that part of that $600,000 annual appropriation.
What if a decision's made that we need to remove?
I really don't think removal of something of that size. The tires are located off of Broward County, and those were permitted artificial reef deployment activity. There were some pilot projects that were done, but a lot of the work that's happening now is from grants from DEP for tire remediation, as well as mitigation for some other activities that are impacting corals. As part of the mitigation for that, those mitigation requirements that are removing those tires. Similarly, it's a 10, 20 year project.
We really fall back onto the county I've yet to see that.
Typically the Army Corps, you know, if it's a navigational obstruction, that's when you'll see they'll mandate the removal, you know. And that has happened before. Okaloosa County, they were towing a barge out. It sank in the navigational channel in Destin Pass. They had to remove it. Sometimes the funding just isn't available, so they're taking out bonds and insurance. So it's a situation that I think reminds us that careful planning is critical, because, you know, you get in a bad situation and it's not practical to remove these structures. Chuck?
Back on the risk, you said that your catch rate on snapper it declined remarkably. Has it declined at other sites in the area?
No.
I mean, in other words, is it a risk problem or is it kind of a reason problem?
Yeah, so Chuck's question is, has the red snapper catch rate declined at other nearby artificial reef sites? And no, they have not. The catch rates have still been very high for red snapper in the area.